are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to the service at First Brethren Church. Good to have you here today. I see a lot of coats, and maybe you move closer together to warm up or whatever, but it's good to have you here today. And we probably have a lot more people watching out there today, standing home to stay warm. And it's good to have you no matter where you are, but it's still better than up north down here, so welcome. We don't have that white stuff falling from the sky. Good to have you here today. We have some announcements, and Pastor Dave has one.
I want to remind you that we are invited to a dinner next Sunday. After the worship service next Sunday, you're invited to join the Ukrainian church over in our fellowship hall, and they want to give a dinner to all of us to thank us for the use of the facilities. I think this is a wonderful time to get to know the people who are sharing the building with us, and also to remember the extension of our ministry that's going on as Jesus Christ is being preached in the Russian language, and people around here who speak Russian and have a Russian culture and Ukrainian culture are hearing about Jesus from them. You don't have to bring any food, so this is like the best potluck. It's a potluck where you get to eat and you don't have to bring food, and
free food.
You're going to get an opportunity to experience cuisine that is very, very different. But it's really good. And so hopefully, you know, we like to experience new things. I'd like to encourage you to come. Could you give me an idea of who would be, I'd like to have kind of a rough idea of who would think about coming to something like that next week. So if you would consider that. Okay, all right, so we will let them know, and they want to be able to tell you what a blessing it is that we're allowing them to do this, and they're wonderful people. I think you'll be very pleased with it. I know all of you who have interacted with them have been blessed by that, so encourage you to come, plan on it, and we'll see you there.
It's good to know we got free food coming up, so be there with everybody, checking that out. The rest of the things are in the bulletin. You can read those, and it's pretty much what we try to do every week, so you shouldn't be surprised by the things that are coming up. So let us enter into a time of worship. And my call to worship today, I'm going to read the scripture in a minute, but you know me, I always have songs bouncing around in my head, and I'm going to read some lyrics to a song, and then I'm going to tell you what my scripture for today is. And this is a song called When We Pray. When we pray, people hurting, people broken, beaten down and feeling hopeless, wonder if it's going to always be this way. Who will speak up for the captive, show some love and heal a past that binds the wounds we think will never go away? But what if we could be a people on our knees as one before the King? Because we believe all the world starts changing when the church starts praying, strongholds start to break. Oh, when we pray, prison walls start shaking at the sound of praising. Nothing stays the same. Oh, when we pray, oh, when we pray. And obviously this artist, his name is Torrin Wells, and he's concerned that we're not praying enough for our fellow Christians. And that brings me to my verse for the day, and it comes out of James 5:16. The Bible commands us to pray for one another. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Please take time to pray not only for yourself, but pray for the people in your lives, and let's make a difference as a church. Because if we don't pray, who's going to be praying? And we got to be examples to the unbeliever that our prayers are making a difference. To that end, let's pray. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for this opportunity to be here today. Lord, a little cold weather in Sarasota is not going to keep us away. We are here to worship you, to be led by the worship team, and then to hear the word of God from Pastor Dave. Thank you for giving us the ability to be here. We thank you for those watching either locally or far away, Lord. Thank you for allowing the technology that this can happen. In your name we pray, amen.
Let's stand together this morning as we sing out our praises to God. The Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. My heart will sing no other name. We sing out Forever Reign. You are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love, you are love. On display for all to see. You are light, you are light. When the darkness closes in, you are hope, you are hope. You have covered all my sin. You are peace, you are peace. When my fear is crippling, you are true, you are true. in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. You are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And no, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus. And no, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name. Jesus, Jesus. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Always, oh, our hearts always hunger. Faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before you. Oh, we're falling before you. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Give the healing and grace. It's always here. Oh, our hearts always hunger. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Amen. You may be seated.
You are the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. But we don't have to go hungry. He's always there to fill us up. He gave the manna in the wilderness, and he certainly feeds us every day with his Holy Spirit, leading and guiding and protecting us. As I go into the prayer requests, I think of there's not one name on this list that's too hard for God. So let our prayers go up in faithfulness to him. First of all, for those with cancer, for Daniel White, for Ava, Mark, Christopher, Heather Fred, Amy Terreri, Catherine Dublin, David Moore, Michelle Demko, Martha Jackson, Alicia, Richard Robinson, Liz Jerome. It's a cold day, I don't see her today. But she's going through a lot. I think she's pretty much finished with the chemo, but they're trying to get her set up for radiation. So that'll be the next step on her journey. So that's something they can do to help with God's help. Jeannie Lindsay's doing pretty well right now, and we're grateful she can be with us. And we have Joya, Angel Gonzalez, Bobby Joe McAdams, Fionata, Joshua Well, the 16-year-old with leukemia. So pray for all of those cancer patients and all the trials that they have to go through with their treatment. For their health problems, we have Lisa, Jacob, and Evan, the Yoy family. Lisa had a hematoma drain this week, and she couldn't get to rehab until the drain gets taken off now. So we're hoping early this week she'll make it to the rehab. But she is doing a lot better with walking in the hospital and being able to get around a lot better than she was. So we are encouraged that good things are ahead for the family. Be with Maria. There's several Marias. One Maria called me this morning and said to tell everybody hello because she couldn't come today, but she sure will miss the service. And she especially mentioned your name, Pastor David. And that's Hernandez and her two boys. And we have Gracie here with us today. God bless you, Gracie, and he has, for the fact that you are able to be here today. We continue to pray for Washington's health and that he will find Jesus. For Connie, for Wendy, for Jill, who's having, I believe, another procedure this week, keep her in your prayers that they can get. God will see feel fit to heal her totally so that she doesn't have pain anymore. For Estrella Morales, for Billy, for the Deckmar family who are all going through health issues and procedures, for Nancy Strasser, for Danny Wright, for Eleanor, for Richard Kelly, for John Showalter, who's doing much better. We praise God for you today, John. We'll continue to pray for you. For Larry Shoemaker, for Evelyn Tidy, for Susanna Cartmill, for Troy Shea, for Jackie Hostetler, for Luz Gutierrez. I know she has procedures sometime this month. So maybe you can keep me posted, sister, when we know some, hopefully some good news. And Charles, our Charles, with CT scan. He had, I think on Wednesday, they still don't have results from that. But he's having a major problem with eating. You think, oh, eating, that's easy. But sometimes it's not when you have so many stomach issues going on. So we hope they can get to the bottom of that. Keep Oliver Schweitzer. He was a little young man that had a new heart put in many years ago. But what is he, about 13, I think, now? He's having problems, so please pray for him, that he can grow up and mature as any normal boy would expect to at this point in his life, instead of running to doctors and specialists and that kind of thing, which are ahead for him. And be with the revival of our country. I think we can't say that enough. We need revival desperately. We need revival in our community, in our families. Wherever you look, there's somebody who needs to find the Lord. So keep our lights burning and try to witness to those people and bring them in. We want to remember grief, the family of Betty Pitcock and Marsha Locklear. And I want you to remember also our missionaries, Claire and Evan, they're over in Turkey. And we want to pray for Ukraine, for Israel, and for Gaza. And continue to pray for my granddaughter, Sienna Helmuth, and Gavin Wright, who are in the Marines in the boot camp, and they're almost done. Praise God, she's almost made it. You got a couple more weeks yet, and then she'll graduate. So we just praise God that he's been walking with her through this journey. God bless all of you.
Thank you, Iris, for the reminders of what we need to pray for and thank God for the praises. And hope everybody had a good week and are looking forward to what Pastor Dave's going to preach today and the week that's ahead of us. And I know time goes fast and things happen quickly. And as I was telling you in the call to worship, my burden this week is for the people around us. It's easy to get up in the morning and look in the mirror and say, thank you, Lord, you gave me another day. But it's really hard to focus on other people. And even the disciples asked Jesus, how should we pray? And we shouldn't be afraid to ask him how we should pray. And I really have a burden in our world today that we're forgetting about people that are really even are very close to us. They don't even have to be around the world. And we just get caught up in the things that we're doing. And the Lord put it on my heart to focus on the people around us and turn off the TV. When it warms up today, go for a walk and see what God created for us out here. And You're not going to see anything on TV. You're not going to learn anything new on the internet. You're going to learn it by going out and just fellowshipping with God. Last night I put on some Christian music, and boy, it really refreshed my heart. I just turned off the TV, and God really spoke to me, and that's what we need to do. And as I lead us in prayer today, the thing I want you to do, you can do it out there in Facebook and Instagram land, and out there, pray for somebody. I was going to say to you, those of you in here today, pray for the person sitting next to you, but it might be your spouse, and you're probably praying for them anyway. When God gives you a person that comes to your mind, pray for that person today. They could be related. They could be a co-worker. They could be somebody that's been on your heart for a long, long time. And we see it right here in Scripture. We see it every day. When we pray, things happen. When we don't pray, other things happen that are not good. So I'm going to leave that spot at the beginning of the prayer here. Pray for that person. And then as you go out and are ministering this week, keep those people in your lives in prayer all the time, because it makes a big difference. We've all seen it, and it happens. So let's pray. Lord, we are so blessed and we are so honored to be here today. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be here, to be in this fellowship today. Lord, thank you for giving us the health to be here today, Lord. And we know there are a lot of people that would like to be here that can't come because of health reasons. And Lord, Iris just read a lot of those people that would be here if it wasn't for their health, Lord. And Lord, we know that you're watching over them, and you're putting your anointing hand upon them, Lord, and to bring them back into this fellowship as soon as possible. And even though they're not here physically, they're on our minds and they're in our hearts, and we're praying for them as fellow brothers and sisters. And Lord, we just love that about this church, that we care about those that are in the fellowship with us, and we are all going through this life together, Lord, and we are blessed to have a place we can come and we can worship to you with the music and the words we get from Pastor Dave. And Lord, there's just so much in the world today that if we don't put our focus on it, it just kind of goes the other way, Lord. And today, just give us strength to be strong in the face of things and challenges that are happening in our lives, and things that come at our, that tend to get under our way of us being a better believer, a better Christian. And if we don't model those things that Jesus tells us about in the Bible, then who's going to model them, Lord? And the world is not going to do that. We're going to have to point them out and emphasize them and pray for them. And if we want to have a better world, until you call us home, Lord, one of the things that we're to do is to be in fellowship together, lifting up our brothers and sisters and praying for them and helping them in times of need. And Lord, teach us each day that we live this life. May we learn more about the way you want us to live as Christians and as believers. And Lord, I'm just so proud of the people in this church that exhibit those traits and those things every day of their lives. And there have been those that are now with you in heaven that did the same thing growing up in this church, and they always exhibited the way that you should live your life. And Lord, I know today that I'm a better person because of having come in contact with those lives. And Lord, today just give me strength and the challenges that I have and that I face, Lord, and that the people in this congregation face. And we know we can come here together and share those together and be stronger as we walk out these doors. Lord, we pray for not only the things that are on our bulletin, Lord, but we pray for this city, we pray for this state, we pray for this country in the year that's coming up. Satan is running wild in this world, and we want to put leaders that are going to lead us politically in this country that are going to make a difference for you, not a difference for themselves, Lord. And may we make the right decision in the months ahead. And Lord, we pray for this world. There's still conflict in Israel. There's still conflict in Russia and the Ukraine, Lord. And Lord, be with us next Sunday. May we come in fellowship with our brothers and sisters from the Ukraine church and fellowship and break bread together, Lord, and learn more about them and their culture and the concerns on their heart, Lord. And may we be as the church here in this building, that we're letting them come and worship in this building, that may we be an example to them as they are an example to us. Lord, I just feel like there's so much we could continue to pray for, but you know what's on our hearts and our minds, and we're looking forward to hearing the words that you would have us hear today, Lord, and guide us in the week ahead as we enter a new week, and may there be new things that come to our challenges that we're going to overcome and challenges we're going to rise up to. And then when we gather together next Sunday, we can share those with our fellow believers, Lord. Just so proud of the congregation here today. Thank you for sending your son to die for our sins. And it's all because of who you are, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Just wanted to let you know that the flowers that we have on the altar today are from the memorial service that we had for Betty Pitcock, John's mother, and we had a wonderful time of celebration of her life, and they've left the flowers for us to enjoy as well, and it's in her memory. I also want you to know that the air conditioner is set warmer than it is in here, and for some reason it's just not keeping up, so we'll have it looked at and make sure it's working better next week, but we'll probably never need it again. I think this is the first time we've needed it this season, and we'll get it fixed, and then we won't need it for another season probably. Speaking of things that you buy and never use or never hope to use, life insurance. Every year I have a bet with my life insurance agents that I'm going to die. And they bet that I'm not going to. And it sounds like a kind of a weird bet, but they give me good odds for it. It's kind of like 300-to-1 odds that, if I die, they pay a lot more than if I have to pay them. So every year I pay a bit of money, and I hope I don't get anything for it. It's kind of weird buying insurance, isn't it? It's just a weird thing to do. You buy it, and you hope you never use it. But we know that they say there's two things that are certain in this world, death and taxes. The government says, I'm not sure about death, but you're going to be sure about taxes. We know that this life has an end. And no amount of insurance can change that. All they do is if you die, your insurance company will pay somebody else some money. Like, that's a great deal, isn't it? It's kind of like the guy who had a money-back guarantee on his parachute. Doesn't do much good for you, but somebody else may get something for it. So there's no way, no amount of money you can pay that would say, I'm going to be assured of life. You can insure your life and get money if you lose it. But there's no way to assure your life, except there is eternal life in Jesus Christ. And we can be sure of that. So I want to read to you from 2 Timothy chapter 1, starting with verse 8. This is what Paul writes to his protege. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. But it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed, and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. Father, as we go to your word, may we understand it, may it go into our minds and into our hearts and souls, and Father, may it become part of us as we live into your truth. In Christ's name we pray, amen. So we're talking today about life assurance, that you can be sure of your salvation. You ask a lot of people, you know, if you died today, do you know where you would be right afterwards? And a lot of people say, yeah, I hope I'd be in heaven. But that's not enough to be a comfort, is it? To think, well, maybe I'll make it into heaven. And I think those people probably would think that there's no alternative. But if you read the Bible, you realize that you can be sure of your salvation. If you can trust the Bible says you can be sure of your salvation. So then it becomes really important to say, can we trust what the Bible says? And even though that's not the center of what I wanted to talk about today, I think that's important for us to kind of talk about a little bit, because that's a big issue on this. If you're going to be assured of your salvation, you need to deal with your belief about the Bible. Do you have reasons to believe the Bible? We talked about this last week, that you ought to have reasons for the hope that you have, and we ought to have a reasonable faith. You ought to have something that your faith is based on. And so I want you to think about that for yourself. Do you have reason to trust the Bible? And you know my testimony. You know that I said that I wasn't going to become a pastor if I didn't really believe what I was preaching. And so I struggled with this and found that I really did have reason to believe what the Bible teaches. And I have some space. If you want to take it in the notes, you can write them down. But here's what I've come to for why I can base my life on what the Bible teaches. For one thing, there's the historical accuracy of the Bible. There are some holy books of some religions that they just sit by themselves. And what they promote and what they teach is not supported by anything else in the world. But the Bible, Old Testament and New, are both ensconced in the historical record of this world. And you can't check everything in the Bible. You can't make sure, you know, some random dude in the Bible, you can't necessarily find some other evidence that that person actually lived. But many of the things in the Bible have been confirmed by archaeology and by ancient documents. For instance, Old Testament kings, this is not all of them, but all of these, Ahab, Jehu, Joash, Jeroboam II, Uzziah, Menahem, Ahaz, Hezekiah, all of them have historical records outside the Bible that show that they exist. Hezekiah, they found a seal, actually from his signet ring or his seal, whatever he used, where they would press it into clay and then fire it, and it has his name, that this was his seal. So you actually have what amounts to his signature from back then. And there's actually a fingerprint on the corner of it. So we may even have Hezekiah's fingerprint from back then. We know all of these kings. For a long time, they said, well, King David was just kind of legendary. You know, he's kind of like King Arthur. He's the ideal king of the people of Israel. And scholars would sniff and say, well, there's no historical evidence of David outside the Bible, until there was. We now have found three different inscriptions that mention King David from close to his period. He lived about 1000 BC, and from the 10th century and 9th century, we have three records of King David's name. So outside the Bible, that he actually was a real king. There's others in the Bible. By the way, there's other kings as well that we have historical records for from Israel. And these are just Israeli kings. We also have foreign kings. Many of them have records of their own that kind of dovetail and match what the Bible is teaching about their interactions with Israel. Other people in the Bible that we have historical records for, Isaiah, even Balaam. Remember Balaam and his donkey? We have archaeological evidence for him. We've also dug up a bunch of cities. One archaeologist said he dug Israel with a Bible in his hand because he said, you know, if there's a city in the Bible, I'm going to try and find it. And if it says it's in this position, well, there's a big mound of rubble, I'm going to start digging there and find out if that's what it is. And many of the cities have been found that way. Three cities that were interesting were Hazor, Megiddo, and Gezer. These are three Israeli cities. And the important thing about them, the interesting thing, is that the Bible says Solomon built them. And so archaeologists went out to find them, and they found them in the positions where they were said in the Bible to be. And as they dug into this, they found that the archaeology was from the 10th century, from Solomon's time period. And all of them had similar buildings. In fact, they call it Solomon's Gates. You know, back then, the gates weren't just like an archway with a wooden door in it, like you see in medieval castles or something. Gates would have been kind of like a whole building. And Solomon's Gates had three rooms on both sides. And then the gates would have been in the middle between those rooms. Those would have been defensive rooms, but they would always also be used in times of peace for kind of like storefronts or checking out people's credentials and stuff. But they called them Solomon's Gates, and they were in all three of these cities, and all three of the cities were built in the same pattern. So it confirms what the Bible said about these three cities. This is from 1,000 years before Jesus. This was ancient when Jesus was on the earth. There's Samaria, Megiddo, Hazor, Shechem, Dan, Bethshean, Jericho, Gezer, Shiloh, Jerusalem, Hebron, Lachish, and Beersheba are just some of the cities that they've dug that are in Israel. And of course, they found cities in other countries as well. You know, Nineveh and other cities from other empires, they found them as well. They found empires like the Babylonian Empire, the Persian Empire, the Syrian Empire, the Assyrian Empire, the Greek and Roman Empire, the Egyptians, and the Hittites. The Hittites are an interesting example, too. For years, centuries, they didn't know where the Hittites were from. And they often would say, there's no evidence for this Hittite empire. We don't know anything about the Hittites, let alone have a whole empire of these Hittites. And that was the scholarly line until 1906. And in 1906, they found Hattusha, which is the capital of the Hittite Empire. And there they found 10,000 tablets in a royal library that described this empire. And the empire covered most of what we know of as Turkey today, and its influence went all the way down into Syria and Israel, just like the Bible said. And they were a rival of the Egyptians. And so we now have evidence that the Bible was right all along, even though archaeology had never found an entire empire in history had been lost. But the Bible had testimony about it, and eventually they found it. Old Testament manuscripts are pretty important evidence as well. There was a long time when people thought, you know, our oldest manuscripts of the Bible were maybe 1,000 years old. I wonder what they used to say before they were corrupted. And actually, some cults use that. They say, oh, well, you know, the Bible, you can't trust the Bible because it's been corrupted over time. And so it was an amazing thing. Probably the greatest archaeological discovery ever was when the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered. A Bedouin shepherd was throwing a rock into a cave, and he heard pottery breaking, and he went in and found all these jars with rolled up scrolls, probably from the Qumran community nearby, where they had copied those scrolls and hid them away. These Dead Sea Scrolls, they dated them from 250 BC to 100 AD. So 250 years before Christ, all the way up to the time of Christ and his life. So these scrolls, these actual paper scrolls, papyrus scrolls or whatever, they are older than the time of Christ, most of them. And some of them were Old Testament manuscripts. They have the whole book of Isaiah, and they have parts of other Old Testament manuscripts as well. And people started to say, let's find out what the Bible was back 1,000 years older than anything we have. And they started studying it, and they realized it was almost identical. Which is really surprising when you think about it, because can you imagine copying a Bible by hand? And can you imagine trying to do it without any errors? And then when you copied it, somebody else copied it later, and somebody else copied it later, do that for 1,000 years and expect it to be similar? You ever play telephone when you were a kid, where you whispered something in somebody's ear and you go all the way around a circle, and by the time it gets to the end, it means nothing like what it was meaning at the first place? That's what people expected from the Bible. And they found out that it was so accurate, it was unbelievable. And one reason that had happened, and those of you who are into computers, John, you'll appreciate this. They used a checksum. You know a checksum? In computers, when they send a wad of data over the internet, what they'll do is they'll take all the information in there and they'll add it all together and they'll come up with a unique number. And they'll send that number along with that packet of information. And when it receives it, the receiving computer will take all that information, add it all up, and see if it agrees with that number. And if one bit of information is out of order or wrong, if one zero or one is switched, that number will be different. And we'll say, please send that again. And that's how we have reliable communication over kind of scratchy cables. That's what they did. The Hebrews would copy a paragraph, and I think it might have been the whole page. When they got done, they would count every little part of every letter. And they'd get down to the end and they'd write that number. And then when the copier would copy it, he'd count his and he'd write down his number, and then he'd see if the number agreed. And if it didn't, they'd take the manuscript and they'd burn it. They got some points for accuracy. Can you imagine? You get all the way down to the end of the book of Isaiah and you're like, oh no, I made a mistake. They didn't have white out. They didn't scrape it off. They burned it because they didn't want that mistake to get passed on to the future. They didn't want to have a cross out and something else down there. So they were extremely accurate in conveying the book that they were copying. But we have also found one scroll that's older than the Dead Sea Scrolls. In fact, they call it the Hinnom Scrolls. These were put on silver foil, rolled up and put into a little container to be worn as an amulet. And it was the scripture from Numbers 6 that sometimes we sing, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. That blessing was written on a silver scroll, rolled up, put in an amulet, 600 years before Jesus Christ. And they found it and they unrolled it. And that is the oldest, complete verse that we have that's written in Hebrew from 600 years before Christ. So we know these things have been found that show some people have said, well, the books of Moses were written after the exile, after the people of Israel were taken to Babylon and then they came back. Then they made up this whole story about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses and everything else. But now we have a physical scroll with a verse from those books that's before the exile. So it's pretty amazing that we even have that. I think the early dating of the New Testament as well shows that we have a reliable witness. You know, if something happens and then somebody writes it down 500 years later, you might think that there's some legendary elements in it. But if something happens and somebody writes it down 20 or 30 years later, and they put in a lot of embellishments and lies, well, you might have that book, but you won't have a lot of people that will believe it, because if anything's common knowledge in that, then people will know that that's not true. They're still alive, and they still witnessed that. You know, if I were to write a book that JFK actually survived his assassination and ran for office again and became president again, nobody would believe it, because there's still people alive who were there when he was assassinated or saw it on TV or whatever. We have an early witness in the New Testament. The three Gospels and James and Paul's letters were all written in the 40s and 60s, 40s to 60s. So that's, you know, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years after the time of Christ, after his death and resurrection. John's Gospels, his letters, and Revelation were written from the 80s to the 90s. So he was the latest witness to that. But all of that is within that first century. We actually have scraps of papyrus, one scrap of papyrus of the Gospel of John, just part of the Gospel of John, that's dated to 125 AD. So this is less than 40 years after it was written. We have an actual physical manuscript of it. Many manuscripts of the New Testament are from the 2nd and 3rd century, so they're very early as well. So when the New Testament was written, many of the eyewitnesses were still alive. And that's what Paul argued in 1 Corinthians 15. Most of them are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. And the challenge is obvious. If you don't believe me, go and talk to them. And you can talk to the people who actually saw Jesus alive again. And that brings up another reason for believing the Bible. I believe that the crucifixion itself and the resurrection puts a stamp of approval on God's word. I usually believe somebody who says they're going to die and they're going to be raised again on the third day. If it happens, I think that probably everything else they said probably has some more weight to it. And I think that's a story for Jesus. Even most non-believing scholars agree with the facts, the basic facts, that Jesus Christ was crucified by Pontius Pilate, that there was an empty tomb afterwards, and that the followers, including the first followers being women, they claim that they saw him again, and not in some ghostly apparition or some far-off view, but they actually sat down and ate with him and talked with him and spent time with him. Somehow we have to come to grips with that and explain that. And I believe that it's because what they actually saw was actually true. Another thing about the Bible is fulfilled prophecy. And you read about prophecies and then you read about their fulfillment. Like the destruction of Tyre. The city of Tyre was prophesied that it would be destroyed so completely that they would scrape the dust off the city. Not just reduce it to rubble, but they wouldn't be content with that. They'd scrape the dust. Well, look, what army does that? They have better things to do, but that's actually what they did in Tyre. Because when they destroyed the city on the mainland, there was still an island offshore that was part of the city, and Alexander the Great took all of the rubble and the dust from the city of Tyre, poured it into the Mediterranean, and built a causeway out to the island so that he could bring all of his weapons of war up and destroy that island. The city of Tyre was destroyed completely, just like the Bible said it would. When Jesus looked at the temple and he said, there's not going to be one stone on another. Can you imagine seeing this temple built out of stones that were tens of tons for every single stone? And for somebody to say, yeah, this is going to be destroyed so much, not one stone will be on another. And if you go to Israel today, you can see the Western Wall, which is kind of the foundation of the platform that the temple was on. But there is no trace of the temple, except at the foot of the wall, there's rubble that they have left to show what they found when they dug into the sand and exposed it, showing all the stones that have been thrown off of the Temple Mount, from the temple as well as probably from some other buildings as well. But they threw those stones off, and there is not one stone of the temple that remains on another stone. The suffering servant in Isaiah 53, you read that, you read the story of Jesus written 700 years before Jesus was born. Daniel prophesied about the empires of Babylon and Persia and Greece and Rome and said that they would come in quick succession. And then another kingdom would come that would supplant them all, and that would be God's kingdom. All of these things say there's a reason to believe what God's word says. And the wonderful thing is then you can believe the wonderful promises that God put in his word. As Paul said, I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted him until that day. What a wonderful way to live life, to be able to trust that the one you believe in is holding on, and he's going to make sure that everything you've invested in him pays off on that day. Paul would also write in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. So that's a promise from God's word. If you believe and understand what he's talking about by belief there, the whole testimony of the Bible makes clear that's not just a belief of a theory. That's putting your trust in Jesus Christ. If you put your trust in Jesus Christ, that is the salvation to everyone who believes. That's a promise. Not to some, not to occasionally people who believe. Hebrews 10:22-23 says, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. This is one of those examples that show that hope in the Bible is not a wish for a preferred future. Hope in the Bible is an expectation, a settled expectation that what you have been promised is going to come. So what do? We trust Jesus. We put our whole trust in him. Eternal life is given to those who trust Jesus. That's the promise of God. And the wonderful thing about that is, you know, the childish view of heaven is that good people go to heaven and bad people go to hell. But there's a problem with that belief, and that is that we're all sinners. None of us deserves to demand a presence with God. None of us in our natural state could even abide by our relationship with God. God does not abide with sin because of his nature. And so we're lost as long as nothing's done about the sin in our life. And if it were true that goodness gets you into heaven, then we'd always have to say, well, I'm not perfect, so how good do I have to be? And those who believe in salvation by works or salvation by the law or by goodness, they'll always say, I hope I make it. I hope I've done enough good to make up for any bad that I've done. But if it's not based on my goodness, but on Jesus' goodness, I don't have to wonder, can I make it? Yeah, Jesus is good enough. He's going to get me in because he promised. And that's the promise in God's word. John 3:14-16, Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Everyone who believes, not some of the ones who believe. So if you put your faith in him, if you put your trust in him, you're not going to be disappointed. And you don't have to go around wondering, I wonder if I did it good enough. Because it's not about your goodness, it's about Jesus. Romans 8:1 and following said, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh. The law of Moses, it's a good law. God's law is a good law, but it can't save you because it's weakened by the flesh, because you can't fulfill it. That's not the purpose of the law. I've often said that the law is a thermometer, not a thermostat. A thermometer will tell you what temperature it is. A thermostat does something about it. I can't tell you that today because our thermostat's not doing anything about it. But the law tells us we need a Savior. It can't save you, but it shows you that you need one. And thank God we have Jesus. 1 John 5:12 says, "Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life." It's as simple as that. Jesus made it possible for anybody to come to him. Galatians 3:6 says, "So also Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness." Some people say, well, in the Old Testament, people were saved by the law, but in the New Testament, people are saved by grace. Not at all. You go back to Genesis 3:6, and it says, Abraham believed God, so he put his trust in the promise of God that eventually was the precursor of Jesus Christ. He put his faith in God. And what happened? It was credited to him. It was given to him. It was gifted to him. Righteousness. And so Abraham is saved the same way you and I are saved, by putting his faith in Jesus Christ. He never heard the name of Jesus, but he knew the promise that his seed would bless the whole world. And Abraham believed that. And in that, Abraham, without knowing it, was putting his faith in Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that Jesus is the only way. I already read you 1 John 5:12 that said, "Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life." So he's the dividing line. And the passage that we started with in 2 Timothy, it showed, he said, it's not by our choice. It's not by our works that we do this. So there is no other way. Jesus Christ is the only way. Acts 4:12 says, "Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." There's no other name. But thank God there doesn't have to be, because Jesus is enough for all of us. And when we put our trust in him, the Bible says you will not be disappointed in that. How do we know that we've received this? Well, when Jesus comes in, he changes everything. And he changes our life. He changes our heart. He changes our soul. You're not saved by good works, but once you're saved, he changes you. So Jesus changes everything, including our lives. Romans 6:15-18, it says, "What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the ones you obey? Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that now has claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness." What a blessing. We've all been slaves to sin. We all look back and say, "God, how can you love somebody like me?" We've all fallen short of the glory of God. And he talks about that. You've offered yourself to be slaves. Thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. God can deal with where we've been. He's going to help us to get where we need to be. He's not done with us yet, but he's working on us. And we can be sure that he's going to complete that work. Paul said, I know the one I believe, and he's going to keep everything I've committed to him for that day. One day, every one of us is going to stand before the Lord. And right then, the only thing that's going to matter is when we look at Jesus and he claims us as his own. And when that happens, we will not be disappointed. That's the assurance of life. We can face this life, and every year we get closer to the day when we won't be on this earth anymore. But we can know that there's a life to come. Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for the comfort and peace you give to us, knowing that you have made provision for us, that we sinners can be made righteous, and in Christ we are made righteous. Not a righteousness of our own, but the righteousness of Jesus. It's hard to fathom, Father. It's hard to believe such a good news can come. But Father, I thank you that there's a life that we have with you. Thank you, Father, for the future. I pray, Father, for all of our loved ones, all the people of this earth, to find you and to know that there is a future for them as well. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me? We're going to sing a song appropriately, Blessed Assurance. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Let's all sing, and the altar is open as we sing together.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Father, I thank you that you have a place prepared for us. And I pray, Father, that you'll use the rest of our lives to prepare us for that place. I pray, Father, for the stories that we develop here, for the life that we live here, to be our testimony that we can tell for eternity. I pray, Father, that you'll guide us and direct us in the days ahead. Go with us now, Lord, and dismiss us with your blessing. And may we stay in the center of your will. May we accomplish the purpose for which you have made us on this earth. Go with us now, Lord. Guide us and direct us in it all. And we ask all this in Jesus' precious name, and all God's people said, Amen. Amen.